قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى وَمَنْ يَقْتَرِفْ حَسَنَةً نَزِدْ لَهُ فِيهَا حُسْنًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ شَكُورٌ صلوات عليك وعلى آله. This is the famous ayat known as ayat of Mawadda from surah number 42 of the Quran, ayat number 23. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding the Prophet that, O Muhammad, say to your people, your followers, لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى, that when it comes to the hard work that I have done in conveying the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to you, I do not ask for any reward or any compensation from you, إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى, except one thing. And this is Allah's command to him, that you say this, إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى, except to love my family. And then as if to explain the importance of that act of loving the family of the Prophet, the ayat goes on, وَمَنْ يَقْتَرِفْ حَسَنَةً, and whoever acquires the hasana, hasana means a good deed. And this good deed here refers to the love for the families, the family of the Prophet. Whoever acquires that good deed, نَزِدْ لَهُ فِيهَا حُسْنًا, Allah says, we will increase in his goodness. So you do something good, Allah is going to multiply that. إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ شَكُورٌ, indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all forgiving. One of the important benefits of the law of Ahlul Bayt is that Allah is all forgiving. But the title after that, the attribute there, is very unusual. He says he is Ghafoor, he is all forgiving and Shakur, which means he will thank you for expressing your appreciation to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The gathering that we have to remember the wafat of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in a way an expression of that love. Because when we talk about love, it's not only for Ali Muhammad, it is also for Muhammad himself and for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All these events that we have, wafayat and viladats, these are all expression of our devotion and love to the Prophet and his family. Tonight I would like to talk about an issue which is, of course, everyone sitting here believes in that. And that's not the point. The point is that sometimes we hear questions about what we believe in. And if we just let it go, that, you know, oh, he's a Shia, he must believe in it. But then they go here and there, they hear things. And sometimes, you know, falsehood is multiplied again and again. You start then questioning and doubting your own beliefs. And the question that I have tonight is, what did the Prophet of Islam leave behind? Did he leave something behind for the Ummah? It's a very simple question. You ask any Sunni Muslim, they will say yes. The Prophet, in one of his sayings, according to them, he says, I'm leaving two precious things behind. One is Kitabullah wa Sunnati, the book of Allah and my Sunnat and tradition. We are not against the Sunnah of Rasulullah, but that's not the point here. You ask any Shia, what did the Prophet leave behind? Any Shia who knows about his own deen and mazhab, his response will be that the Prophet said, I am leaving two precious things behind, Kitabullah wa itrati. I am leaving two things behind, two precious things. One is the book of Allah and one is my family. And this is where we see two different versions of the same so-called message from Rasulullah about what he is leaving behind. And this is where we have to, you know, basically look at this. And what I'm going to do tonight is I'm not even going to the Shia sources. Which of these two versions are considered to be authentic according to Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah? You go to any masjid, you hear the khutbah, any lecture from any scholar from that school of thought, you will always hear Kitabullah wa Sunnati, that the Prophet said, I'm leaving the Quran and my Sunnah and tradition. When we look at the hadith, you know, the compilation of hadith, of course, was done later on. For us, since our imams were there, accessible to us till the 11th imam, the urgency or the question of compiling a hadith among the Shias was not there. It, you know, came around later on when the ghaybat came, you know, closer. And that's why you have Sheikh Kulaini, who lived in Ghaybat al-Sughra, and he's the one who compiled the first compilation of hadith among Shias, known as Al-Kafi, Usul and Furu both. But just a generation before that, the most famous compiler of hadith among Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah is Bukhari. And others came later on. In all, among the Sunnis, there are six books known to be Ṣiḥãḥ as-Sittah, which means the six authentic books of hadith. This is the title given by themselves to these six books and compilation of hadith. You have al-Bukhari, you know, who died in 256. After him, you have Muslim, 261 he died. Then Ibn Majah, he died in 264. Abu Dawud comes after him, he died in 275. Then at-Tirmizi, he died in 273. And then Imam Nasai, who died in 303 of the Hijrah. And when we look at this hadith, where the Prophet says, you know, if you look at the name there on the screen, we can bring the first part of the screen now. Where the Prophet says, "Inni tarikum fiikum saqalain," I am leaving two precious things among you. Kitabullah, the first one, there is no dispute about it. What is after Kitabullah? Is it itrati or sunnati? Let us look at the Sunni version of it. If you check Sahih Bukhari, it is not there. If you check Sahih Muslim, it is not there. If you check Ibn Majah's Sunan, it is not there. If you look at the Sunan of Abu Dawud, it is not to be found in there. If you look at the Sahih of Tirmidhi, it is not there. Even if you look at the last of the six, Sahih Sittah of Imam Nasai in Sunan, you will not find Kitabullah wa Sunnati mentioned in any of the six collection of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. But they go on and repeating it. So where did it come from? You know, the question is, where did it come from? The earliest source among Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah who mentions this is Imam Malik. Of course, his compilation is not considered to be among the Ṣiḥãḥ as-Sittah. He has a book called Al-Muwatta, and there he narrates there, and also in Sirah, Ibn Hisham, and in the biography of the Prophet, he mentions that. But it's interesting that both of these early sources who mentioned that the Prophet says, Kitabullah wa Sunnati, both these narrations are mursal. Mursal means there is no sanad there, no chain of narrators. Doesn't say so-and-so heard from so-and-so, who heard from so-and-so, going back to Rasulullah. And when you have a narration in a hadith book which is mursal, without sanad, according to the Shi'a and the Sunni ulama of hadith, it is no validity at all. And so the issue comes up, you know, what about those who came later on? Because there were also compilations done by Hakim Nishapuri and others who came later on to write books on Mustadrak al-Sayhan and others. Well, others who came later on, they have this version, Kitabullah wa Sunnati, with Sanad. But this is the whole issue, that although, you know, they come with Sanad, but go and study the books of the Sunni scholars who scrutinize the Ahadith. Almost all of them will agree that the later books who have this version of Kitabullah wa Sunnati with Sanad and the chain of narrators, it is all either weak or totally an outright fabrication. I'll just, you know, quote to you one scholar from the contemporary times in Jordan, Sheikh Hassan bin Ali al-Saqaf. He's not a Shia scholar, who has studied this because he was asked about this. What is the right version? Is it Kitabullah wa Itrati or Kitabullah wa Sunnati? And so he responds to it, and he has included that his question answer in his book, known as Ṣiḥīḥ Sifāti Salātin Nabī, the right way of the prophet, the prayers of the Prophet. And there, right in the beginning, it says, as far as this version where it says Kitabullah wa Sunnati, فَأَمَّا لَفْظُ وَسُنَّتِي فَلَا أَشُكُّ بِأَنَّهُ مَوْضُوعٌ. It says, as far as the version which says Sunnati, I don't have any doubt that this is actually a fabrication, لِضَعْفِ سَنَدِهِ, because its chain of narrator is weak, وَوَحَاتِهِ, and it is feebleness in the whole content, وَلِعَوَامِلٍ أُمَوِيَّ أَصَّرَتْ فِي ذَلِكَ. He says the agents of Banu Umayyah have actually put their influence in this hadith. This is a contemporary Sunni alim. Then he actually goes on to say, he has actually other remarks which I'll you know, come to that later on. But there was something very, very interesting even for me. You know, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. You forced me to come and, you know, recite here, and I'm forced to do some research. And when I get happy, you get the sawab for it. There is something I didn't know till yesterday. Thinking about it, reading about it, the further research on this issue actually brings me to a very, very astonishing conclusion. Who was the person who invented these words, Kitabullah wa Sunnati? It's not Rasulullah. It is not in Ṣiḥãḥ as-Sittah. Other books of hadith from Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, their own ulama, including the contemporary scholars of hadith among them, say this is mawdu', this is fabricated, made up hadith, you know, not reliable at all. What is the source of this? Where does this idea come up from? There is actually a book known as Tariq Wasit, by Aslam bin Sahal al-Wasiti, where he quotes the narrations that he has through his source, going all the way to al-Miswar bin Makhrama, who said, Qala Umar ibn al-Khattab, this is his last days, he's talking to his friends, people from Quraysh, not all Muslims. He says, Ya ma'shar Quraysh, O people of Quraysh, these are the Muhajireen, not even Ansar of Medina. He says, إِنِّي لَا أَقْشَ عَلَيْكُمْ. I don't have any fear about you. Because, you know, alhamdulillah, I have established everything for you, so your interests are preserved. And then he says, وَتَّرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ عَمْرَيْنِ. And I'm leaving two things for you. لَنْ تَظِلُّ بَعْدُهُمَا. Ajeeb. Using the same words that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used in the hadith of Saqalayn. He says, تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ عَمْرَيْنِ. I'm leaving two things among you. لَنْ تَظِلُّ بَعْدُهُمَا. As long as you are with those two things, you will never go astray. كتاب الله جل وعز وسنة نبيه. This is where you see all other hadiths are now being, you know, corrected and edited in order to fit these words of Umar ibn Khattab. So the actual source of this idea of كتاب الله وسنتي or Sunnat Nabiyihi, this is not from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at all. Salawat alayhi wa sallam. What about the other version? Inni tarikum fikum as-saqalayn kitabullah wa itrati. That I'm leaving two things behind. Two precious things. One is the book of Allah, and the other is my family. Sometimes it says, itratu ahlu bayti. Just emphasizing it even more. As I said, I'm not going to the Shia source. Again, we go to Ṣiḥãḥ as-Sittah. Can you put on the slide again, please? And let us look one by one. Sahih al-Bukhari doesn't have it. Usko hamesha bukhar aa jata tha. Sahih Muslim has that. Kitabullah wa itrati. Sunan ibn Majah, it has Kitabullah wa itrati. Sunan Abu Dawood, it has Kitabullah wa itrati. Sahih Tirmidhi, it has Kitabullah wa itrati. Sunan Nisa'i, it has Kitabullah wa itrati. Five out of the six as-Ṣiḥãḥ as-Sittah, the main collection of hadith among Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, have this version of Rasulullah's statement where he says, I'm leaving two precious things behind. One is the book of Allah and the other is my family. As long as you hold on to them, you will never go astray, and they will never separate from one another until they meet me on the day of Qiyamah by the fountain of Kawthar. Salawat pranayi parab. Bukhari, we don't have to worry about him. We know his bias against Amir al-Mu'mineen. He will do whatever he can to omit anything which is in the praise of Ali or to dilute anything which is in which is going against the Khulafa. In the year 2012, in the same majlis, we had looked at the issue of the last will of Rasulullah, where we looked at the version from Sahih Bukhari, where he is in six different places. He talks about it, and we looked at it in detail. In three cases, where the wordings used to reject the will of the Prophet, and to say that, you know, he is saying things which na'uzu billah is nonsensical, he doesn't use the name who said it. He says, qalu. People said this in his presence. We don't want this. Three other versions in the same book where he has the milder version of the story, he mentions the name of Umar ibn Khattab. And this is where, you know, basically we are surprised. You know, how come the same person, when his last days come, he's leaving things behind for the ummah? Kitabullah wa sunnata nabiyyihi. Lan tadhillu ba'duhuma. When Rasulullah wanted to write it, he said, we don't need it. Hasbuna kitabullah. You know, you look what they did with Rasulullah and what they are doing themselves. They basically are placing themselves above Rasulullah. Rasulullah had no concern for the ummah. They were more concerned for the ummah. You know, if you want to remember that story more, go back to the, we have in the archives, the majlis we had two nights in the year 2012 about it. Salawat man ikbar. The contemporary Jordanian scholar Sheikh Hassan bin Ali al-Saqaf, he actually then looks at the version of Kitabullah wa Itrati and even the narration which is there from Kitabullah wa Sunnati. At the end he concludes, he says, فَتَبَيَّنَا, and he talks about the sanad and the narrators, the ruwat. Then he says, فَتَبَيَّنَا بِوُضُوحٍ, it has become very clear أن حديث كتاب الله وعترتي هو الصحيح. That the version which says كتاب الله وعترتي, the book of Allah and my family, is the صحيح version. الثابت في صحيح مسلم. It has been proven that to be in صحيح مسلم also. وأن لفظ كتاب الله وسنتي باطل من جهة السند غير صحيح. And the version of Kitabullah wa Sunnati is invalid because of the weak sanad, and it is غير صحيح. It is not an authentic version. And then he is actually now appealing to his own, you know, colleagues. He says, فعلى خطباء المساجد والمعاذ والعائمة أن يتركوا اللفظ الذي لم يرد عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. He says it is the duty of the speakers in the masjid and the wa'az, you know, the khatib of the Jummah and the speakers and the aima of masajid, to abandon the version which has not come from Rasulullah. This is where we are saying, you go anywhere, you will hear the same words. And he being from Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, he knows the problem. And now he's advising the people. He says, I urge you, all the khutaba and the wu'az and the a'imma of masajib, and yatruku al-lafzu alladhi lam yaridan Rasulullah. You know, to abandon the wordings which has not come from Rasulullah. Wa an yadhkuru lin-nasi al-lafzu al-sahih, and to mention to the people the right version of it, al-thabit anhu alayhi salati wa salam, and the one which is proven to be from him, في صحيح مسلم كتاب الله وأهل بيتي أو كتاب الله وعترتي صلوات برنا هيك برا. Let me narrate to you actually the hadith that we have from صحيح مسلم before I go to the Urdu part. This is a very interesting narration from Sahih Muslim. A person by the name of Yazid bin Hayyan, he says, one day I, with two of my friends, Hussein bin Sabra and Umar ibn Muslim, we went to a companion of the Prophet who had become old those days by the name of Zayd bin Arqam. Zayd bin Arqam is a very famous Sahabi of the Prophet. His name comes in many narrations. فَلَمَّا جَلَسْنَا عَلَيْهِ, he says, when we went to meet him, we sat down. He says, Hussein started talking to him and he says that, O Zayd, you have seen plenty good things. You saw Rasulullah, you heard from him, you participated in the jihad with him, you prayed behind him, and O Zayd, you know, you basically are a very blessed person. حدثني يا زيد ما سمعت من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. So now these are the second generation of the Sahaba. They had not seen the Prophet. And so they went to Zayd bin Arqam and they said, you know, can you narrate a hadith that you yourself have heard from Rasulullah? And Zayd bin Arqam says, Ya ibn Akhi, this fellow happens to be his nephew. He says, Wallahi laqad kabirat sinni. You know, I've become very old now. Qaduma ahdi, the time has passed away. وَنَسِيتُ بَعْضَ الَّذِي كُنْتُ أَعِي مِنَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ And many things that I used to hear from Rasulullah are starting forgetting them because of my age and the gap in the time. فَلَمَّا حَدَّسَتْكُمْ فَقْبِلُوا So whatever I narrate to you, accept it. Whatever I don't narrate, don't push, you know, to hear from me because maybe I have not remembered. And then, this is subhanAllah. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, once He decides to preserve the truth, He uses all His different means. The enemies can do whatever they want, but it will come out. You suppress His one place, it will come out from the other place. And so Zayd bin Arqam there, he says, قَامَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَآلَهُ وَسَلَّمْ يَوْمًا فِينَا خَطِيبًا One day the Prophet stood up to give a khutbah, bima'in yud'a khumman, by the pond which is known as khum, ghadire. The word ghadir means the pond. He says this was the pond of khum, where the Prophet stood up to give a khutbah bayna Makkah wal Madina, between the cities of Makkah and Madina. Fahamid Allah wa athna alayhi, he praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَوَعَزَ He advised us on many, many things. وَذَكَّرَ And reminded us about many, many things. أَمَّا بَعَدْ Then he says, that the Prophet then says, أَلَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ O people, فَإِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ يُوشَكَ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ رَسُولُ رَبِّي فَأُجِيبَ I'm a human being. I'm not an immortal, you know, I'm not going to live forever. I'm a human being. And very soon the messenger of Allah in form of the angel of death is going to come. And when he comes, I had to respond to his call. وَعَنَا And therefore, this is very important. So he's putting this, you know, the background. Why I'm doing this now? My time of death is now approaching close. And so he says, when I will be called by Malakul Maut, I will respond. وَعَنَا تَارِكٌ فِيكُمْ سَقَلَيْنِ And therefore, I am leaving two important things, precious things among you. أَوَّلُهُمَا كِتَابُ اللَّهِ The first of them is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فِيهِ الْهُدَى وَالنُّورِ In this book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will have guidance and light. فَخُذُوا بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ وَاسْتَمْسِكُوا بِهِ Therefore, hold strongly to the book of Allah and, you know, cling yourself to it. فَحَسَّ عَلَىٰ كِتَابِ اللَّهِ وَرَغَّبَ فِيهِ So Zayd bin Arqam says, the Prophet then emphasized that we should be closer to the Qur'an. ثُمَّ قَال Zayd bin Arqam now continues the narration of the Prophet, that he said the first one was Kitabullah. وَأَهْلُ بَيْتِي And then the Prophet said the second one is my family. So he's putting the Qur'an and the Ahlul Bayt on the same level. I'm leaving these two things for you. What is it? Just to kiss the Qur'an and to kiss the hand of Ahlul Bayt? No. Qur'an is hidayat, Ahlul Bayt is hidayat. Qur'an is nur, Ahlul Bayt is nur. Hold on to the Qur'an, hold on to the Ahlul Bayt. And then the Prophet, and this is an interesting version, which is not found in all other narrations that we have. He says, "Wa ahlu bayti," and the second of the two things I'm living is my family. Udhakkirukum Allah fi ahli bayti. Udhakkirukum Allah fi ahli bayti. أذكركم الله في أهل بيتي. Basically, the Prophet three times reminds them. He says, I remind you of Allah regarding your duty towards my family. I remind you of Allah towards, you know, regarding the duty towards my family. And the emphasis is three times. And this is where we have to realize that when we talk about following the Ahlul Bayt, this is not just a, you know, things made up by the Shias. In the talk today, I have not referred to a single Shi'i sources here. Everything is coming from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Salawat upon Ek Barar. Some of our brothers, you know, they interact with the other communities and they have no problem at all. But they hear this again and again and again. And when they ask, they say, hey, this is there. Next time they say it's theirs, tell them, show me. Is it in any of this Ṣiḥãḥ as-Sittah or not? And because you hear it again and again, sometimes you start, you know, questioning your own aqeedah. Maybe we are wrong, but no. You know, you have to be assured here that when we look at this issue of the Prophet emphasizing that I'm leaving two things, precious things behind. As long as you hold on to both of them, لَمْ تَضِلُّ بَعْدِي, you will never go astray after me. And this is the foundation of our madhab. This is the legacy that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has left for us. Sahih Muslim ke is riwayat mein, رسول اسلام نے تین بار اذکرکم اللہ فی اہل بیتی. یعنی عجیب و غریب ہے کہ خداوند عالم کو حاضر اور ناظر سمجھو, وہ دیکھ رہا ہے, اور قیامت کے دن تم سے پوچھے گا کہ تم نے محمد کے بعد ان کے آل کے ساتھ کیا کیا. اور اسی لیے آپ دیکھتے ہیں کہ عالم اسلام میں سنیوں میں بھی وہابیوں کو چھوڑ کے, بھلے وہ نہ مانتے ہوں بعنوان خلفاء, لیکن پھر بھی وہ جذبہ محبت اور احترام ہے. اور وہ اسی لیے ہے, خداوند عالم نے قرآن میں اس کا حکم دیا ہے, رسول اسلام نے حدیث میں بیان کیا ہے, بار بار عملی طور پہ اس مسئلے کو دہرایا ہے. لہٰذا اس حدیث کے بارے میں کوئی شک و شبے کی گنجائش ایبسولوٹلی نہیں ہے. چاہے آپ اس کو ہزار بار سنیں دوسروں سے, ان سے سورس مانگیے, اور آپ دیکھیں گے کہ ان کے اوتھینٹک سورسز میں یہ جملہ جو وہ بیان کرتے ہیں وہ نہیں ملے گا, بلکہ جہاں بھی ملے گا وہ یہی ہے, کتاب اللہ و عترتی, اللہ کی کتاب ایک طرف اور محمد کا خاندان دوسری طرف. صلوات پڑھنے ایک بار آؤ. یہ جو ڈویژن کی بات ہوتی ہے, اکثر ہم لوگ کہتے ہیں کہ رسول اللہ کے بعد یہ افتراق آیا ہے. نہیں, رسول کے زمانے میں آلریڈی یہ تصور تھا, بلکہ رسول اللہ کے لیے اپنے زندگی کے آخری ایام بہت ہی تکلیف دہ ایام تھے. عبداللہ ابن عباس وہ جو واقعہ بیان کرتے ہیں, رضیت یوم الخمیس, یعنی دی ٹریجڈی آف تھرزڈے, وہی قلم اردوات والا معاملہ ہے. یعنی وہ رسول جو سب کچھ لے کے آئے ہیں, جہاں آپ کے عبادت کے احکام کو بیان کرتے ہیں, تجارت کے احکام کو بیان کرتے ہیں, آپ کے نکاح و طلاق کے مسائل کو بیان کرتے ہیں, میراث کے مسائل کو بیان کرتے ہیں, سوشل پولیٹیکل ایشوز میں لیڈرشپ کا رول ادا کرتے ہیں, پریکٹیکلی آپ کے سامنے جنگ میں بھی سردار لشکر کے عنوان سے جاتے ہیں, کسی پہلو زندگی کا رسول اسلام نے چھوڑا نہیں. اور آپ یہ کہتے ہیں حسبنا کتاب اللہ, کہ ہمیں رسول نہیں چاہیے, رسول کے سنت نہیں چاہیے, جو کتاب لے کے آئے وہی ہمارے لیے کافی ہے. اس وقت اگر وہ کافی تھی تو بعد میں کیوں لکھا ہے اپنی وصیت میں کہ کتاب اللہ اور سنت رسول. بات یہ ہے کہ اس عرصے میں انہوں نے سنت کو آلریڈی اپنے لحاظ سے مولڈ کر دیا تھا. جو پسند کی باتیں تھیں اس کو آفیشیل سٹیٹس دیا گیا, جو پسند کی باتیں نہیں تھیں اس کو چھوڑ دیا گیا تھا. اس لیے اب کہتے ہیں کہ ہم اہل سنت والجماعت ہیں, لیکن بنیاد تو وہی تھی نا کہ جب رسول کہہ رہے تھے قلم اور دوات لے کے آؤ تاکہ ہم کچھ لکھیں اور اس کے بعد تم کبھی بھی گمراہ نہیں ہوگے. وہ لوگ جو وہاں موجود تھے وہ ہوشیار تھے, وہ جانتے ہیں کہ رسول نے یہ الفاظ لم تضل بعدی ہمیشہ یوز کیا ہے جب قرآن اور اہل بیت کا ذکر کرتے تھے. وہ سمجھ گئے کہ اب وہ باتیں جو زبانی ہوتی تھی اب وہ چاہتے ہیں اس کو قطباً لکھ دیں. لہذا رسول کے سامنے روکا گیا, دو سپلٹ ہو جاتی ہے وہاں جتنے لوگ تھے. کچھ کہتے تھے قلم اور دوات لایا جائے, کچھ لوگوں نے کہا کہ نہیں ہمارے لیے قرآن جو ہے کافی ہے, رسول اللہ کی طبیعت ٹھیک نہیں ہے. نعوذ باللہ, ذہنی طور پہ توازن جو ہے نعوذ باللہ وہ ٹھیک نہیں ہے. اور وہاں پہ آپ دیکھیں آلریڈی وہ جو تصور ہے نبی کا وہ وہاں بدل رہا ہے, اور ہم فخر کرتے ہیں کہ ہم نے رسول کے اس تقدس کو ہمیشہ محفوظ رکھا ہے. خود وفات کے بعد بھی آپ دیکھیں کہ جب غسل و کفن کے بعد اسی کمرے میں, اس لیے کہ رسول نے کہا تھا کہ یہ نبی جو ہیں خصوصاً رسول اسلام کے بارے میں یہ تھا کہ جہاں وفات ہوگی وہیں غسل ہوگا, وہیں وہ دفن کیے جائیں گے. اور وہاں بھی آپ دیکھیں کہ جب نماز جنازہ کی بات ہوئی, اکثر ہم لوگ سمجھتے ہیں ممکن ہے بہت بڑا اجتماع ہوا ہوگا, مسجد میں جنازہ لایا گیا ہوگا. نہیں, امیر المومنین انچارج تھے, دوسرے لوگ تو بیزی تھے سیاست میں, رسول اسلام انچارج تھے. انہوں نے غسل دیا, کفن دیا, نماز پڑھی, اور اس کے بعد کمرہ اتنا بڑا نہیں تھا رسول اللہ کا. علی جو ہے 3 سے 5 افراد کو اجازت دیتے تھے وہ جائیں اور وہاں نماز فرادا پڑھیں, اس لیے کہ علی کا جملہ تھا کہ رسول اللہ ہمارے امام ہے حیًا و میتًا, وہ زندہ ہیں تب بھی ہمارے امام ہیں, مرنے کے بعد بھی ہوں وہ ہمارے امام ہیں. نماز جنازہ جماعت کی شکل میں نہیں ہوگی ان کے حضور, یعنی رسول کے باڈی کے پریزنس میں بھی کوئی امام نہیں بن سکتا. تو وہ 3 سے 5 لوگ جاتے تھے, دین ادرز ول کم آؤٹ, اینڈ پھر دوسرے جاتے تھے. اسی طرح سے یہ تصور ہمارے یہاں ہے کہ رسول اسلام کی حرمت جو ہے اپنی جگہ پہ ہے, اور اس حرمت کو خود خداوند عالم نے بھی محفوظ رکھا ہے. آخر میں وہ وقت آتا ہے کہ گھر والے آ چکے ہیں قریب. جناب ام سلمہ کی روایت ہے کہ ازواج جو ہیں وہ دروازے کے باہر بیٹھی تھی, دے کوڈ سی رسول اللہ, دے کوڈ ہیئر, لیکن وہ وہاں ڈائریکٹلی نہیں تھی. بستر کے پاس امیر المومنین تھے, رسول اللہ کو اپنے گود میں لیے ہوئے تھے, اور سیدہ قریب میں بیٹھی تھی. اور یہ وقت اس وقت کی بات ہے کہ جب اب رسول کی آنکھ زیادہ تر بند رہتی تھی, نیم غشی کا عالم تھا, لیکن بیٹی جو قریب بیٹھی تھی, یقیناً وہ باپ جن کی بیٹیاں ہیں وہ جانتے ہیں کہ بیٹی جو ہے ماں باپ کے جنازے پہ سب سے زیادہ روتی ہے. فاطمہ پہلو میں بیٹھی تھی, اس طرح کے سر جو ہے رسول اللہ کے چہرے کے اوپر تھا, اور روتے ہوئے آنسو کے قطرے کچھ رسول اللہ کے چہرے پر گرتے ہیں. رسول نے آنکھ کھولی اور فرماتے ہیں کہ بیٹی کیوں رو رہی ہو؟ قریب بلاتے ہیں, کچھ کہا جس کو سننے کے بعد فاطمہ کے چہرے پر مسکراہٹ آ جاتی ہے. ایک روایت کے مطابق بعد میں ازواج نے پوچھا کہ رسول اللہ نے آپ سے کیا کہا تھا, تو کئی دنوں کے بعد جناب سیدہ نے کہا کہ اس وقت رسول نے کہا تھا بیٹی
باپ کی جدائی میں اتنا مت رو اس لیے کہ ہم تمہیں خبر دے رہے ہیں کہ میرے بعد گھر والوں میں سب سے پہلے جو ہم سے آ کے ملے گا مرنے کے بعد وہ تم ہی ہوگی. اور یہ سن کے ہمیں ایک لحاظ سے تسلی ملی. اور تھوڑی دیر کے بعد دق الباب ہوتا ہے اور جب سیدہ نے کہا کہ میرے بابا کی طبیعت ٹھیک نہیں ہے اللہ اور ملائکہ حرمت رسول اللہ کا خیال کرتے ہیں. رسول نے کہا کہ بیٹی یہ آنے والا کسی گھر کے اجازت نہیں لیتا, یہ ملک الموت ہے, یہ اس گھر کا شرف ہے کہ یہ اجازت دے رہا ہے ملک الموت آئے. قبض روح کیا ہے بس جس قبر کو روح کے بعد امیر المومنین اور گھر بنو ہاشم کے تمام افراد نے واہ محمد آ اور واہ مصطفیٰ کا نعرہ شروع کر دیا. عزاداران حسین, رسول اللہ کو علی اور بنو ہاشم اور انصار میں سے ایک شخص نے آ کے غسل دیا اور غسل کے بعد تدفین ہوئی. لیکن آیت قرآن اور مودت کے لحاظ سے ہونا تو یہ چاہیے تھا کہ رسول کے وفات کے بعد ان کی ایک ہی بیٹی ہے ان کو پرسہ دیا جائے. عزاداران حسین, رسول اللہ کی سیرت تھی کہ جس گھر میں میت ہو تین دن تک دھواں نہ نکلے, مطلب یہ تھا کہ وہاں کھانا جو ہے رشتہ دار یا ہمسایا لے کے آئے. عزاداران حسین, فاطمہ کو پرسہ دیا گیا اس دروازے پر دھواں بھی نظر آیا, وہ اس لیے نہیں تھا کہ کھانا پک رہا تھا بلکہ فاطمہ کے ہم گھر پر حملہ ہوا تھا. یہاں تک کہ جب فاطمہ بابا کو یاد کر کے روتی تھی محلے والے آخر میں آتے ہیں, فاطمہ امیر المومنین سے کہتے ہیں کہ فاطمہ کے رونے سے ہمیں پریشانی ہوتی ہے, یا تو دن میں روئیں یا رات میں روئیں. عزاداران حسین, امیر المومنین نے جنت البقیع میں انتظام کیا, ایک مختصر سا بیت الحزن کی تعمیر کی اور روزانہ فاطمہ حسن اور حسین کے ہاتھ کو پکڑ کے جنت البقیع جاتی تھی, بابا کو روتی تھی اور شام کے بعد لوٹ کے آتی تھی. فاطمہ سے کہیں گے کہ اے فاطمہ پھر بھی بہت خوش نصیب تھی, علی تو موجود تھے انہوں نے بیت الحزن بنا دیا, لیکن مجھے ایک اور یتیم بچی یاد آتی ہے جو عاشور کے دن شام کو بابا کی تلاش میں نکلی, اسے کوئی نہ ملا. آخر میں جب آواز دیتی ہے ایک میت نے دو ہاتھ اٹھائے یا سکینہ الیہ الیہ, اور وہ بچی جب بھی باپ کو یاد کرتی تھی شمر ملعون تازیانے اور تماچا مارتا تھا. اور اسی لیے سیدہ کے یہ جملہ تھا کہ بابا آپ کے بعد اتنے مصائب ٹوٹے ہیں کہ اگر دن پر گرتے تو رات کی تاریکی میں بدل جائیں گی. لیکن اس فاطمہ کا یہ فقرہ ام کلثوم نے اس وقت یاد کیا ہے جب شام سے رہائی کے بعد مدینہ پہنچی ہے اور وہاں جو مرثیہ پڑا ہے فاطمہ کے قبر سے مخاطب ہوتی ہے, کہتی ہے ماں فاطمہ آپ نے کہا تھا کہ اتنے مصائب آپ پر ٹوٹے ہیں, کاش آپ دیکھتی رسول اللہ کے نواسیوں کو کس طرح سے اسیر اور قیدی بنائی گئی. اور خاص ذکر کرتی ہے سکینہ پر کہ سکینہ جب بھی تازیانے سے آزادی ہوتی تھی وہ پکارتی تھی الغوث یا رب العالمین, لیکن کوئی جواب دینے والا نہ تھا. الا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين سيعلم الذين ظلموا اي منقلب ينقلبون. خداوند اس خیبات قبول فرما, ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے, ہماری توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما. خداوند شیعہ ناری جہاں جہاں کو اپنے حفظ امان میں رکھ. خداوند تکفیری افواج جہاں جہاں بھی ہیں ان کے تمام صلاحیت کو نیست و نابود فرما. امام کے زور میں تعجیل فرما. ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم. ماتم و سعید.